I'd like to welcome everyone to the January the 9th, 2012 regular meeting of the Mayodan Town Council. And at this time, we'd ask you to please stand and for the invocation be given by Penn Center.
Let us bow. Our Heavenly Father, we're thankful for the health and the strength you've blessed us with today. For the goodness and the mercy you showed over us, our kinfolk, our citizens of this town. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that you bestow upon us. As we go about your business tonight for the betterment of this community, help us, Lord, to have wisdom above our experiences in making decisions what will affect the town and the government of it. Bless us all. Practice the golden rule every day that we live. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
First thing on the agenda tonight is the public comment period, and no one signed up for the public comment period, so we'll move right along. We had the approval of the minutes of the agenda meeting December the 8th, 2011, and the regular meeting December the 12th, 2011. All of you have a copy of them. Have you had time to look over them?
Take a note to approve.
Motion by Councilman Martin to approve. Second. Second by Lewis. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion's carried. The old business is the discussion of the regarding the roof repair, the bids report. Charlie, do you have that?
Okay. We have received three bids, from one from Guaranteed Systems Incorporated, one from KMS, and one from CCI, and after review of the bids, staff is recommending that you go with the lowest responsible bidder, which is Guaranteed Systems Inc. for a proposal total of $8,000 for the roof repair, and I would recommend an additional $1,200 for the gutter repair if I feel it's necessary that we get that gutter repair, so we include that in the bid for a total of $9,200.
I'll make a motion we accept Guaranteed Systems bid for $9,200.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion by Councilman Simpson and a second by Councilman Martin to accept the $9,200 bid from Guaranteed Systems. Any further discussion? Not all in favor, let it be known by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion's carried. Move on down to new business, the presentation of the 2010-2011 audit by Rex Rouse.
Thank you, Mayor. First of all, I'd like to introduce my wife, Judy, from Mayodan. And Henrietta Wheeler, who worked a lot on this job. Henrietta passed three parts of the CPA exam. Just has one more left. Looking forward to her getting CPA in the near future. It's nice to see my old friends back up here on the board. First of all, if you'll turn to page one of the audit report inside the binder, the opinions. We've audited the financial statements of the town of Mayodan for the year ending June 30, 2011. And in the second paragraph, state we conducted our audit in accordance with generally accepted auditing standards. And in the third paragraph, in our opinion, the financial statements referred to above present fairly, in all material respects, the financial position and results of operation and changes financial position, cash flows of all of the funds of the town of Mayodan in conformity with generally accepted accounting principles. First of all, if you turn to page 55, we have the comparative balance sheet of the general fund. If you look at the total fund balance, the second row at the bottom from the bottom of the page, You notice that the total fund balance improved from $1,234,002 at the beginning of the year in the right-hand column to $1,478,563. And that's an increase of $244,561. So that is very good for the general fund to have a total fund balance of $1,478,563. On page 55, the line right above that, note that the fund balance available for appropriation, the unassigned fund balance, is $848,244. Last year it was $714,037. And if you hold your finger there on page 55 and turn to page 62. On page 62, about halfway down the page, you'll see total expenditures. In the second column is the actual column. The actual expenditures for last year were $2,156,718. And if you'll take the $848,424 on page 55, the unassigned fund balance, and divide that by the $2,156,718, the total expenditures for the year, you get 39.34%. That means that your fund balance is 39% or better than one-third or 4 months working fund balance in relation to your total expenditures. The average statewide level of available fund balance for towns in about this size is about 36%. So the town of Mayodan is somewhat above the statewide average now. In the town of Mayodan's unassigned fund balance at June 30, 2010, last year was 35.45%, but just about even with the statewide average. Now if you'll turn to page 57, still in the general fund, the budget revenues in the first column, about three-fourths of the way down the page on 57. First column, the budgeted revenues were $2,324,29, and the actual revenues were $2,373,60, and they gave you a favorable variance. The actual revenues exceeded your budget estimated revenues by $49,931. The actual revenues were also up from the prior year when they were $2,275,723. The most significant increase, I'm going over now, the most significant increases in the revenue accounts compared with the prior year. The franchise tax, this is on page 56. The franchise tax, about the middle of the page, last year, in the last column, the franchise tax was $335,993. This year was $367,874. So that provided an increase of $31,881. And then down near the bottom of page 56, the town received a state fire grant in the amount of $13,498 and a FEMA grant, a fire department grant, in the amount of $33,155, which you did not receive last year. And so that's part of the increase in the revenues. Also on page 57, near the bottom of the revenue account, you had the solid waste equity proceeds, and this came from the city of Reedsville because they were late participating in the solid waste county solid waste program. So this came through the county from the city of Regional who wanted to join the solid waste program of Rockingham County. And also you had the property settlement on the old Coke building, $17,500. And those are the, that accounts for most of the increase in revenue over last year. If you turn back to page 62, about halfway down the page, in the first column, the total budgeted operating expenditures total $2,471,349. The actual expenditures were $2,156,718. So your actual expenditures were $314,631 less than the budgeted expenditures. Last year, your total expenditures in the general fund were $2,014,191. That's in the last column. So actual expenditures in the general fund were up by $142,526, and that's 7.08%. And the items that were up in the general fund, in public buildings on page 58, were up $7,962. The biggest item in this was caused by the purchase of the parking lot at a cost of $35,000. On page 59, in the police department, the expenditures were up from $901,055 last year to $974,951 this year. And that was mostly on account of the several new police vehicles that were acquired. Last year, your police vehicles cost $20,886. This year, they were $76,845. Then the fire department expenditures were up from $136,488 to $166,060, and this is primarily the result of FEMA equipment grant expenditures, the last item in the fire department. We'll turn it on to the comparative balance sheet in the water and sewer fund. That's on page 69. The first item is your unrestricted cash, and it's up from $2,694,339 to $3,128,232. So that's a significant increase in your unrestricted cash. Also, your restricted cash down near the middle of the page was down from $102,513 to $42,644. And as construction on the capital projects progressed, you took money out of the restricted cash and paid for some of those disbursements, but that's why that's down. Fixed assets, net of accumulated depreciation, were up some from $15,460,362. Last year, this year there were $15,577,224. And total debt of the water and sewer fund, this is the about the fifth item from the bottom of the page. Last year your total debt was $7,363,579, and that reduced $6,988,560, primarily resulting from the net retirement of long-term debt in the amount of $312,858 for the year ending June 30th, 2011, and unearned revenue in the amount of $189,813, which was offset by the collection of receivables from the towns of Madison and Stoneville. There, Mayodan is ultimately responsible for this debt, but you have receivables about the seventh or eighth line from the top. Most of this due from other governments, non-current assets, are the amounts. It was $2,467,566 at the beginning of the year. $2,277,753 due from Madison and Stoneville at the end of the year. And so you're collecting those receivables to help pay off the debt. The water and sewer income statement starts on page 70. And up near the top of the page, about the 10th item from the top, total operating revenues. This year, the total operating revenues in the left-hand column was $2,074,337. Last year, they were $2,089,217. So they're down a little bit, down by $14,880. But that's really not very significant in the overall scheme of things. Talking about over $2 million of revenue. On page 72, total operating expenses, page 72, total operating expenses in about the middle of the page increased from $1,772,858 last year to $1,817,314 this year. So your operating expenses in the water and sewer fund increased by $44,456. And that's an increase of only 2.51%. That's less than the inflation rate for last year. On page 72, the net income, this is down third line from the bottom. This year was $613,603. Last year was $721,888. And the Water and Sewer Fund received capital contribution grants this year of $383,353. Last year you received contribution grants of $426,170. Depreciation expense in the middle of the page. Last year depreciation in the Water and Sewer Fund amounted to $433,347. It's about the same this year. This year it's $435,169. Now if you'll turn back to page 33. The bottom of the page, we have the changes in capital assets, the general capital assets, and at the beginning of the year, your capital assets, the general capital assets amounted to $1,907,787. At the end of the year, they were $1,930,291. So you had a net increase of $22,504. The acquisitions during the year totaled $223,893. And your depreciation expense on the general fixed assets totaled $201,389. And that difference accounts for that $222,504 net increase. The details of long-term debt appear starting on page 43, and they're summarized on page 47. At the top of page 47, I state that the legal debt margin of the town's June 30th, 2011 was $15,049,181. The debt margin is 8% of the assessed valuation. Hold your finger on page 47 and turn to page 81. First column, you have the property valuation. You have the net levy, third item under property valuation, $188,114,758. That's the total property valuation of the whole town. And if you take 8% of that, you get the $15,049,181, and that's the maximum debt that the town can have. Your actual debt is consists of $466,477 in governmental activities and $4,268,066 in business type activities. But those amounts include a lot of debt that's due way out into the future, and the compensated absences, the net pension obligation, the net OPEB obligation, and they're all included in that. And those obligations total $525,564. And if you take your total debt minus those pension obligations and the OPEB is other than pension employee benefits. That's the health insurance for retirees. That's getting to be a significant thing now. Your debt on installment purchases and for the wastewater treatment plant totals $4,208,980. The construction loan for the regional wastewater treatment plant, balance on that is $3,281,338. You have $489,414 for the public works facilities building, $10,768 for the purchase of the sanitation truck, $68,660 for the purchase of the new fire and police vehicles, and $358,800 installment loan for the 2 million gallon water tank. Turning back to page 81, you find an analysis of the current tax levy. The current year's collection rate was 97.93% compared with 98.36% for the prior year. The statewide average is about 97%, and that's a reflection on the citizens of the town of Mayodan have always had a good habit of paying their property taxes, and that speaks well for the town. The property tax collection rate for property excluding the registered motor vehicles was 98.67%. In the past, we presented a management letter, but now we include the significant findings inside the financial statements, and they're listed as findings, financial statement findings, on page 90. The two major items that are addressed here, and the first one, the segregation of duties. We have this in all of the small towns that we audit, and small not-for-profits and all the other small governmental units that we audit. There's a lack of segregation of duties, and transactions could be mishandled. The duties should be separated as much as possible, and alternative controls should be used to compensate for lack of separation. The town is aware of the potential deficiency in internal control due to the limited number of employees, and the response was that we will continue to attempt to separate the duties as much as possible and use alternative controls to help compensate for lack of separation. The second item is we still have a significant problem concerning too many adjusting journal entries. This year, material adjusting entries proposed by the auditor are an indication of material weakness in internal control, even if management makes the correction. This year we had 28 adjusting entries required in the general fund, and that compares with 32 entries last year. So a little bit of improvement, but not as much as improvement as we hoped for and expected. Now there were 13 adjusting entries required in the water and soil fund, compared to 26 last year. So there was significant improvement, reduced the number of adjusting entries in the water and sewer fund by half. And so there was significant improvement in the water and sewer fund. And also in the general fund, although we had a lot of adjusting entries, a lot of them affected the net assets positively and a lot of them affected negatively. But the net effect of all of these adjustments only amounted to $3,323, which is fairly immaterial net effect this last year. In the water and sewer fund, although you only had 13 adjusting entries, the adjusting interest had a negative net effect on net assets in the amount of $32,517. Most of these entries, I would say about 85% of them, the amounts change every year, but the theory of the adjustments, about 85% of them are the same and are recurring from year to year, 85 to 90%. Most all of the adjustments are the same type of adjustments. So the key to reducing these entries is to carefully review all of the entries that we made this year with a view toward reducing that number of adjusting entries next year. The finance officer should attend courses offered to finance officers by the local government commission and Institute of Government. The two or three of these basic courses are aimed at and should help reduce the number of adjusting entries. And we'll be glad to help him understand these entries that we made this year all that we can. The town acknowledges that material adjusting entries proposed by the auditor are a potential indication of material weakness in internal control, even if management makes the correction. We will carefully review all of this year's adjusting entries in an effort to reduce the number of adjusting journal entries. Finally, we will encourage a finance officer to avail himself of the many courses offered by the local government commission and Institute of Government. We're also required to issue a SAS 114 letter, and that's the supplemental letter that should be in the front of your report. The main thing on in this is that, in my view, is that at the top of the second page, I state that Williams County has no significant difficulties in dealing with management and performing and completing their audits. We had good cooperation from all the town personnel that we worked with in the audit. We appreciate your cooperation and enabling us to continue to do this job. Thank you. Any questions about anything? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Rick. The new business is with the Hannah and Edwin Barker dispute over a water bill. Please state your name.
My name is Anna Barker. I live at 100 Hairstone Road. We moved in there about July. And the reason we're here is that our first water bill after we moved in there was the just water, not sewer, not garbage pickup, $273 and some change. I came down here, I said there's got to be a decimal point wrong somewhere. Can't be that high. There's no way two adults use that much water. We've lived in Mayodan for on and off for over 25 years. We've never had a water bill with the sewer over $70. We were not using an abnormal amount of water, not doing anything different. In fact, it was the smallest household we've ever had. They said, nope, that's what the meter said. You use that water. You must have a leak. So I contacted the property owner, who is the church next door, and We looked everything over in the house. We couldn't find a leak anywhere. We couldn't find a soggy spot in the yard. Nothing. We said, well, whatever it was, maybe it's fixed itself. Maybe it's gone away, whatever it was. Wait and see what the next bill brings. The next bill was $230. Now, during that initial inspection, we did find that a toilet in the basement was running for a few seconds every about 10 minutes or so. We cut that toilet off, decided to wait and see. Surely it didn't use that much water. Thought we'd wait and see what the next bill brought. It did come down about $50. Still, $230 is a ridiculous amount for just water, no sewer. Even if it was sewer, it was a ridiculous amount. So I called the town again. I asked for a printout of what the house had used previously before we moved in there. And Clifford was sent up to the house with the printout. He checked the meter. He said, it's not running now. He said, but when I came here 2 weeks ago and read the meter, it was running and it did have a high reading. He said, but nobody was here. So, we haven't done anything to change it. The property owners didn't fix anything. But miraculously, our next bill is $31. You know, my thing is, if we didn't do anything to fix it or change it, where did the water go that I had to pay for? We had to sacrifice a lot to pay for that water. And, you know, you don't have any choice. You have to pay it or it's cut off, which it was both times before I could come up with the money to pay for it. When I asked Clifford, when he noticed that the meter was running fast and that was high reading, he said he put on the report that he brought back to the office that we had a possible leak. But nobody notified me in any way that we might have a possible leak. Nobody dropped me a note. Nobody cut the water off so I would call to find out why. Nobody put a note on the door. Nobody gave me a call or anything. But at any rate, we did not have a leak. Yet we've had to pay over $500, $600 worth of water that we didn't use. And I'd like some explanation or restitution on that. There's common sense says we didn't use that water.
But you did have a commode that was leaking.
It didn't. When we turned the commode off, the next bill came down by $50. But the bill was 10 times higher than what the average bill should have been for the house. I checked with several of my neighbors in my research. They say their water bills run between $25 and $32 a month. Mine was running 10 times that. That toilet did not use 10 times the amount of water a normal household does. I've talked to people who work in the business. They said I could have left a faucet running full blast for a month and not accounting for that much water. We did whatever we could do to find out what had been on our end that might have caused the problem. We done what we needed to do to rectify that problem. It still didn't rectify it. But then suddenly, it's fixed. And I know leaks don't fix themselves. And I understand that when I've asked questions, I was told the meters are accurate. They don't make mistakes. They don't quit working. They don't break. They're accurate. In my opinion, they're man-made. they are possible of messing up. I also believe that there's human error that could be a problem, but I shouldn't have to pay for it. If the error is not on my part, I shouldn't have to pay for it.
Well, normally what we would do in a situation like that, would they make an adjustment to the sewer, and you don't have sewer, so according to our policy, then there's no action, nothing, no course that we can take on.
So I'm just out the money and for something I didn't use, for something that I should not have been charged for. There's no way I could have used that much water. We did not have an in-ground pool in the back. We and we probably actually use less water than most households because my husband showers at work. I mean, and it's just the two of us there. And, you know, I'll take the next step I need to take to try to pursue it further if you can tell me there's nothing you can do that it's out of your hands. But I really feel like that, you know, I've been done wrongly. And unfairly. Not only did I have to pay the high water bills, but because it was so high, I ended up getting cut off before I could come up with the money. And then that's extra late fees and cut reconnect fees that added to it each time.
The only thing we can base our decision on is what water goes through the meter.
I understand.
We don't have any other thing to go by. Clifford, was the meter working fine?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay. Well, I don't see how we can make an adjustment. If our equipment's working right and water goes through it, it's the landowner or the homeowner's responsibility as soon as it crosses that meter.
Then where did it go?
I wasn't there, I don't know.
I would, you know, appreciate some kind of an idea, some kind of a suggestion. Where did it go? It did not come through my house. There's no wet spot in the yard. All of the plumbing runs through the basement. There's nothing wet in the basement. And if it was out of anybody else's pocket, they would have a dispute about it as well. You don't like paying for something you didn't use, you didn't purchase. And then in this situation, you know, if you don't want to pay for something that you don't want to purchase, you don't purchase it. I did not buy it. I did not use this water. I did not use this utility, but I'm forced to pay for it.
Well, I can think of a similar situation that church I attended met in about 30 years ago. At our fellowship hall, between the meter and the fellowship hall, we had a line to break. We used 108,000 gallons of water. That's why it was real. We didn't have a wet spot. Basement didn't leak anything.
Why would it? Did it fix itself?
No, we had to have it fixed.
Okay. This healed itself. This pipe, this busted pipe, healed itself.
But you did indicate that a toilet was running.
It was.
Well, on the first bill, but the second bill, it shouldn't be there.
But the second bill, if I'm not mistaken, when you were reading for the second bill and found that problem, you were already into that second billing cycle, were you not?
It still should have made more than a $50 difference. If that was the cause. And yes, we're the only two people in the house, and that toilet was running for a couple seconds every 10 minutes or so. We knew that it wasn't the problem, but we cut it off anyway just to make sure because we didn't use it anyway. It's a second toilet in the basement, and we didn't use it at any rate, so we just went ahead and cut it off. And it only made a $50 difference. Now, you know, something's fishy somewhere. I wouldn't be here bringing a complaint before a bunch of people that I don't know and putting my nerves through this if I felt that I was responsible for it.
What was your last water bill?
The
this will add
$31.13. A normal bill. And that supposedly came down that much without anybody doing anything to fix it.
Except you turned the toilet off.
We did the billing cycle before that.
But the second billing cycle, you were already 6 weeks into the second one before you paid the first one.
It still shouldn't have come, quit altogether by, within the next one line.
If you turn the toilet off, the toilet can leak a lot more than you really realize.
I really do not believe that toilet was using that much water, and it only dropped $50 on the second bill after turning the toilet off.
But you were already into the second period, so it only had a chance to affect itself, $50 worth payment. Had it been turned off the entire cycle, it very well could have been the entire difference right there that dropped it from $230 to $31.
What would be my next step to take it further?
You cut it off under the sink, right?
It was the toilet.
Okay. I got an example. I've got one in my main bathroom right now. And I went under it and I turned it and cut it all the way off as far as it would go. Okay, then I started working on it, come to find out that it wasn't cut off. If I was you, I would have that thing, I'd have that cutoff checked.
There's a cutoff under the toilet and there's one further up on the wall. When we cut the one off underneath the toilet, it would still, the water was still running in the toilet. You know, it would fill back up when you flushed it. Mm-hmm. That cutoff didn't work. So we traced it back and found another cutoff on the wall and turned it off there. So we already went that route.
Okay.
So, did you go to the meter and check and see if it was running after you turned that cutoff off coming in?
Yes.
Yeah, meter wasn't running?
No.
Well, they're clipping. They're designed that they just don't run unless they've got water flowing.
You guys open something up, the water that flows through.
And another
just
thing
by design. What percentage of bad meters do you think you've ever found, or how many have you ever found?
I came here 20 years ago, there really wasn't a meter changeout program. And when I came in, Steve Schumo, we started doing meter changeouts. That is fairly a new meter over there compared to some of the ovens we got. Most of the meters, the old meters, were Badgers and Delcos. They're gone. This is a master meter. That's a pretty good meter. Which
Mr.
we're buying Neptunes now.
Go in and turn the toilet on sometimes for gatherings or something? Was that not something?
No. Because, like I said, if I'm going to turn that on, that's a waste of, because it's going to keep running. So once it's cut off, you don't cut it back on.
If I can't get any restitution for this here, who do I see next? Utilities Commission?
You may want to consult with an attorney as to what your options are.
I appreciate it.
Thank you for your time and thank you for hearing me.
Our next item on the new business would be Bill Scheib, man in First Baptist Church, Community Guard.
Oh.
I represent First Baptist Church here in Mayodan. A couple years ago, I had a vision that was placed on my heart after working with a food pantry for a few years to start a community garden and to supply folks that really need food, that can't afford food, to eat like they should. And looked around for a couple years and Randy Jessup had a couple plots of land out in the sticks and decided, well, so many deer running around, I'm not saying there's many around, here. But worked on this a little bit and found a plot of land on a corner of 4th and the Madison, about 100 yards down from Darrell. It's been used the last couple, 3 years. And talked to Randy again about this plot of land and several guys at the church and ladies at the church. And thought this would be a good location to have a community garden. This garden, we would work primarily with youth and whoever would want to volunteer to provide food for the food pantries here in the local area here in town. To have a successful garden, you have to supply water. And Norman Williams plowed that thing a bunch of times, and I noticed his crops growing, and they come along. We've had some rough summers the last couple. And talking to a couple other gentlemen, and said that there's a possible water supply there. Found a fire hydrant. I called up Deborah Compton, extension agent from up where she came down, and we talked, and she said there's a grant I can apply for, and she said you can probably get that grant if you can have water for your garden. I said, yes, ma'am. So it all kind of 360 right around to itself again. But the reason I'm here is there's a water, a fire hydrant on a corner. I know in Eden, there's a low poverty area that the town has had a tap, whatever it's called, to the water supply in the street. Compton area in Cambridge area in Eden, in Reesville, and a Presbyterian church in Reesville also have water supplies for community gardens. So, gang, the reason I'm here is I'm asking if there's a possibility that you could help supply water in this community garden for the folks in this area. And once the tap is set up, I know that Deborah said that there's one person in charge has a key. I don't know how the water's reduced from the main line to the fire hydrant. I don't know any of that. I know they have a water supply. What I'm asking you all is, if there's a possibility you could help with this, because probably it wouldn't do a hill of beans to plant a garden and try to work it and produce food for folks that need it. And I'm asking you if there's a possibility that we could tap into a line and the church could use that area and produce that food. Also, the water in the other two communities is free. They trust one gentleman with the key that's in charge of that, which would be me, and to see that that place is watered, turned off, no one else gets a key, and I would control that. So that's the reason I'm here. I think it's a great cause for their working with the food pantry. There's so many folks, unbelievably, that can't afford to feed their families, and we'd like to help. That's the reason I'm here. I don't know where I go from here, but that's the reason I am here. Questions?
Well, it sounds like a good idea, Bill.
That
helping people out the best way you can is a good neighborly thing to do. We discussed it Thursday night, and we have a problem tapping on the fire hydrant,
okay,
producing that. That would be out of the question. We couldn't do that.
Okay.
Probabilities. So that leaves us, we'd have to put a water tap on somebody else's property. And it's not ours.
Okay.
And that kind of leaves us in a little liability.
Okay.
One solution would be, you got a neighbor up the street and a neighbor beside you. Borrow their water and get donations to pay their water bill. What was it? $625 was a tap fee?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We could buy a lot of get a lot of donations for water for $625.
Hmm.
I expect water will be about the cheapest thing you put on the garden. What would 1,000 gallons of water be?
$3.62 per 1,000 gallons.
And then sewer would be the same thing?
$3.62 per 1,000?
$3.62.
Oh. I'm talking about water. Okay. So take that a little bit.
So a little bit over $7 for 1,000 gallons of water. Just pay your neighbor to use his water,
mm-hmm,
would be the easiest solution.
You think that would be a possibility?
Well, I know Wes Moore's across the street. Now, Randy said something that, I'm talking way out of turn. I used to do that sometimes. The home down across the street, the church, it's not there anymore. TJ actually told me this first. He said, I don't know if we pay that water bill or not. And that this is kind of foreign from what you just said, too, because I'm still on this tap thing. But he said, I know we have a trash can there, and I don't know if we're paying for the sewage and the water and so forth at that place. I said, I guarantee if you still have a trash can, you're still paying for it. So he said, if there's a possibility to transfer the water bill from there to the plot up the street. But you say that it's just too much to go with to put a tap in it, correct? Mm-hmm. That's the bottom line.
Yeah.
Because you realize, like Tim said, we couldn't put a water tap on the fire hydrant.
I have no clue how that would work.
We're taking a chance on if we have a fine area or whatever, you know.
Well, ask this, I'm not real smart, but how do you reckon Reesville and Eden went to the street, they went to the line of the street, and they tapped in off the water line of the street? I don't know. I'm asking something I don't know.
That's what the tap fee would be. They tapped onto the main line, 7 meter box, and they put a outside faucet on it, put a gardener's on it. That's probably what they've done.
And you say you guys
not on the hydrant.
You don't believe you can do that?
Oh, it could for $600 some.
You're saying $600 some it could be done.
And that what tap fee was?
$625.
$625 for tap fee. Okay. So I get up six and a quarter. I come back and talk, you probably tap into that. Or if I could borrow water across the street.
Which would be the cheapest thing.
Right. Are you talking about tapped into what?
Just make a regular house tap.
Yes. Because we're still kind of talking about the water now. After the tap, we're talking about the water.
Well, that would be the next step, yes sir.
Right, yeah, we're talking about free water.
Yes sir.
Exactly. So then we have to cover the water.
But well, if you're talking, what was that again?
$3.62
$3.62 per thousand.
You wouldn't have to have sewer if you had an irrigation tank.
Right. See that?
We could take that collection favor of the water.
I think you could get people to give you some money on water. I'll buy you first 1,000 gallons.
I'll buy you for the second.
How about leaving on that tap?
Well, get the church to pay for the tap.
Sir?
Get the church to pay for the tap.
That'll be the next step. That's what it was. That'll be the next step. Well, see, guys, go ahead, sir.
I'm going to say it's not paid. I have to cut it off.
we can afford that. Well, I appreciate your time. You guys did talk about this last Thursday, so we're on the same page.
Before you leave, sir, let me ask a question. If it's an irrigation-only tap, what do they get charged, a minimum water usage bill, or is it just on the
water
use? They
do. If it's an open account, it's going to be 12. 67 per billing cycle for water only.
Okay, so it's really every 2 months a minimum bill of $12.67.
Exactly.
And then depending on how much water is used, it gets added to. So
plus you're just looking at in the summertime too.
Yes.
So it's yes. Water bills aren't going to be that
right.
Much.
So it's going to be maybe say 6 months total. Mm-hmm. That $12, but that's regardless of whether water's running through the meter or not.
Right.
If it's an open account.
Yeah.
Well, okay. Well, it depends on whatever. It's still going to be charged $12 a month.
But they could turn it off.
You would close out their account at the end of the season.
I got you. Okay. Makes sense.
We just can't open up new, you know, we have to be careful because we may get the same request.
I understand.
A week from now.
Yes, I
knew
that.
We
got to
go legally.
Yes, sir.
Everything.
I understand.
Bill, would Dickie be okay with putting a meter there?
I'd ask him.
Wouldn't Dickie Ray have to be the one to apply for the service?
Is he a property owner?
He's a property owner, yeah.
Okay. All right. He gave me some food for thought. Answer a lot of my questions. I appreciate it. I'll be back in touch. I'm going to go watch Alabama beat LSU. Long time.
Okay, the next item is the North Carolina STEP grant. North Carolina Rural Center. And Michael's going to address that.
As we discussed the other night, this is a program that's provided by the North Carolina Rural Center to help with our economic situation, and hopefully that you've taken a look at this grant and it's something that you want to move forward on. As we discussed the other evening, I'll need your help to identify the members of the committee that needs to be formed, but we should at least go for it and try to see if we can secure it. Has the potential to bring about $125,000 worth of income into our town to help us develop economically. So it's not an infrastructure grant, it's more focused on capacity building and leadership building type activities tied to, after that, funds that can be used for actual startups of programs that may lead to additional economic development. Requires very little match, 5% match, and would not take effect until our next fiscal year, so we'd know if we got the grant and then we could budget for it in the next fiscal year. And it would probably be a 3 to 4 year program to carry out if we did the entire grant through the process. As we discussed, I believe that everyone was in favor of the idea of it, but I did want to get your blessing formally to move forward on.
Mike, you said that the first grant could be $25,000.
The first step would be a $25,000
grant. Then the next would be
$100,000. Would be up to
$100,000. I read over that thing this afternoon. I think it'd be worth going after.
Yeah, I think we should go ahead and run up simply. Hard thing to begin. It may not be hard enough to get to these people. I see one person and also the great person that can be. Several problems. That was downtown and everything.
Okay, do we need a motion? Do we have a motion? Okay, a motion, second.
Sorry.
Second, Lewis. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you.
Yeah, departmental report tonight is the police department, Chief Caruso.
Oh, everything's running smooth, answering our calls, we're still walking in businesses, checking our residential areas every day. We have just completed updating all of our business contacts, which means we've made personal contact with all the businesses and churches, got updated information if we have an emergency, and we're trying to do that once a year, and we've done that in the past 3 months. And that takes a while, it's about 127 places we have to go to update that information. You may have heard we had a shooting in early December at the four departments. Without getting into great detail, we got the report on December the 8th and we made an arrest on December the 20th. That gentleman has been charged and he's on house arrest and we hope we're going to have him a residence far outside of Mayodan in the next couple of months for several years. We've also identified a couple of problem areas / groups that we are trying to get ahead of the game on. We think they're going to probably be causing us some problems down the road, so you may see an increased presence at night in certain areas. We may be bringing people in off duty. So if you get calls wondering why all the police are in a certain area, it's because we're trying to stop the problem before it gets out of hand. So I thought we'd let you know about that. But everything else is going good. Anybody got any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
Did you just leave some, you left some cars over, like a car or whatever, Walmart in that area on 135, didn't you?
Some.
I mean, non-staff police cars, just.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just we do that during the holiday season. We try to keep a presence of a police car in the major shopping area.
I know you spent quite a bit of time on that.
Yeah, we did that to try to help them lower the larcenies, and that is our biggest. If you look at the larcenies throughout the year in Mayodan, I would say, just guessing, 70% of those are probably coming from Walmart or Food Lion. But yeah, it works. I mean, a presence, if they see us there, it's really slowing it down a lot. And our breaking and entering were also down there in the season, which is good. So that's normally our busiest time of the year for breaking and entering.
I'm hoping in the year between that and spring, late spring, you and Michael working together can come up with a solution for the park up here to keep people out after 9 o'clock at night and damage the park.
Put a fence in.
Get a big fence in.
I think all the light out there at the playground would be a big deal.
I'll tell you, it's tough because we come by and they know we have a couple cars working and it doesn't take long if we go back out there. If we see them out there after dark, we run them off.
Well, that goes back to what you said earlier, though. You could have some people walking in on, walking.
And that is one of the areas you'll probably see a presence. There's a couple areas that this group is
I know they had to, they've had to paint their gazebo, I don't know how many times a year, you know, flip it?
A whole lot.
A lot. And then they tear it up in the playground, it's just gonna, it's gonna problem.
Well, we tried to get the police department up, but they got shot down.
Not too late.
Y'all wanna do it, we'll move up there right now.
Largest mistake of this time.
Well, we had discussed one time putting lights in the back, but we never did act on it, just discussed it, putting lights back there to shine.
Well, not last year, we discussed it.
Through the playground and up through the gazebo, so maybe that's something we need to look into.
Was that light at that gazebo at one time?
Yeah, but then.
Inside.
It keeps getting bad light.
It's out there.
You need a light pretty high up on a pole there, it's getting bad lights, I think.
It's.
Get this pile of pole on that big one, they have about that big square up there, about half of it.
And then we get calls from the neighbors.
That's what you guys were gonna ask if you get too much.
I don't miss him shining across the pavement.
Get them back shining towards the street, probably the best.
We could.
I'll tell you one thing.
Look at that.
Next time you up our way, look at that street light right above my house. If everyone in town is like that, we'd have plenty of light. That's a good one.
That's a good one for you, but that may not be a good one for others. Some people just don't like it when they light it up.
I don't know, I said when they put a new bulb in that thing, I don't know where they got it, but they need to get some more.
Do you have any reports from any of the other department heads? Thing going good? Cliff? You have anything, Cliff? Right?
Yes, sir. Everything's going well, and just to let y'all know how we have been working together. Charlie shared all his contacts with the fire department so we don't duplicate the services going out there as we get them and then they get them. He's just been feeding them to us so we can just add them to our system. So it saves a lot of time.
Anyone else? Dixie?
Quinn? We'd like to remind y'all about budget presentation dinner in February. Hope all of you will be there.
Have you set an exact date yet?
February 21st.
23rd?
3rd, Tuesday.
6.
6 o'clock to dinner.
21st. Okay. Do we have any other comments from the manager?
The other item that I have is we are looking at a proposed zoning ordinance text amendment regarding accessory structures in the C2 zoning district. And I'm actually going to meet with Mr. Simpson to go over the history of that. It may actually be that we don't necessarily need to do it, but we'll have that discussion and take the zoning board as necessary.
Any other comments from any of the council?
And nothing. I'd just like to say welcome to Cliff for his position. You got our support.
Thank you. Okay, at this time then, we need to entertain a motion that we go into closed session in pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 143-318-11A3, which is attorney-client privileges. Motion by Thaddeus, second by Ben. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?